Tonight's Carabao Cup third-round action comes from Highbury Stadium, where Joey Barton and Fleetwood Town take on an Everton side that kicked off the season in fine form.
Great start for Carlo Ancelotti.
Promised potential and points. Might change the perception, the blue half of Merseyside.
The delivery was beautiful and the finish was deadly.
It's Rodriguez and it is absolutely brilliant. Superb finish. In comes the corner for Calvert-Lewin and there is his hat-trick. Everton mean business. New faces, new purpose.
I think after a long time to suffering, now they have to be happy because we can compete with everyone.
There is certainly a real buzz around Everton at the moment. The Blues have been lifted by some big money summer signings and the manager who has three European Cups to his name. It's been 25 years since Everton last won a trophy, so could this be their year? It's just five players that return their place from the weekend hammering of West Brom. John Pickford, Michael Keane, Luke Dean, Richarlison and the bang-in-form Dominic Calvert-Lewin. Fabian Delph, that's his first game for the Blues since February. The third round is the furthest Fleetwood have ever gone in this competition. Manager Joey Barton is a boyhood Everton fan. Can he inspire his side to a cup set this evening? Former Stoke and Villa midfielder Glenn Whelan starts in the middle of the pitch for Fleetwood. Liverpool loanee Morgan Boys makes his Fleetwood debut. Sam Stubbs, son of former Everton legend Alan Stubbs, takes his place at the heart of the back three. And keep an eye out for 18-year-old James Hill. He's already on the radar of several Premier League clubs. A very good evening. 15 major honours in Everton's trophy cabinet. This one, though, is the one that eludes them. That could change this season. Delighted to have alongside me for this one, Jamie Redknapp and Leon Osman. Gents, welcome along. Leon, let's start with you. Everton, cracking start to the season. There must be a really good feel-good factor around Goodison Park.
There is, largely down to the manager's new signings. You know, when you're bringing in quality players such as he has, it really does raise expectations. And then you back that up with results and that feel-good factor does start to arrive. But what that also brings is higher expectations. And that is, although we're only two, three games into the current season, that's what these current Everton players are dealing with at the moment.
Jamie, take your Liverpool hat off for just a second. Everton, no trophy in 25 years. Should they be zooming in on this one this season?
Absolutely. And they're fast becoming a team that everyone wants to watch. It's obviously early in the season. I was at the game at Tottenham and I was so impressed that day. New players coming into the team. Sometimes it takes a while to bed in, but straight away you could see the direction he wants. He realised last year, a position that you know both Leon and I played in, the midfield wasn't strong enough. They didn't have enough power in that area. He's brought in Decore, he's brought in Allen, and he's obviously got a little bit of stardust as well with some of the other signings. So, you know, James has already become loved by the Evertonians, I'm sure. And it's a strong team today because he knows this is going to be a really difficult game.
OK, so Carlo Ancelotti has managed at the Bernabeu, taking charge of Bayern Munich. Tonight he's not too far from Blackpool and he's talking to David Craig.
Carlo, you've had a fantastic start to the season in the Premier League. Where does this competition stand for Everton this season?
A really important competition. It's one of the competitions where we want to be at our best. We started well, we have a difficult game tonight. We want to go forward because it's a short competition and we want to be there until the end.
Is the seriousness you take the competition reflected in your selection tonight? The likes of Calvert-Lewin, Richarlison all starting this evening?
Yeah, they are in a good momentum, I think, in front. I didn't want to change a lot. And so for this reason, I chose this lineup. I hope that we are able to play a good game.
So strangely confident, Leon Osman says, about Everton's chances this season and going into this game tonight. Is that because, Leon, you look at the team that's been picked and some pretty big guns out tonight, isn't there?
Well, there is. And yet, you know, there's quite a number of changes that he's made to the squad, which does show, first of all, the depth that Carlo Ancelotti has now brought to Everton, but also how serious he wants to take this competition. He's won a lot of silverware down in his time throughout his career. He's won a trophy in his first season at many of his clubs before, and he's looking to take this serious as well. And you look at Everton's bench, you've got Davis, Walcott, Gordon, Keane, all played against Salford in the last round, and I'm pretty sure we'll all be very disappointed to miss out tonight.
I don't know what you think, Leon, but I enjoyed watching Bernard against Salford in a more of a central position. when I watched him a lot for Everton, he's obviously not the most physical. And sometimes when you play wide, it's difficult. You haven't got that many places to go. You can only go down the line or cut inside. He hasn't got the pace to take a winger up on the outside. When he moved into a central area, he sees the picture. He's got a bit more time on the ball. He can play either way. And I think I'm looking forward to this because I think he can still stake a claim in that midfield at times because you don't always need the Decores and the Allens and you need a bit of finesse in there. And he could offer that in that central area. I think it suits him more playing central.
Yeah, well, yeah, it does suit him more. His issue is that when he does go central, he's not as big a goal threat. He tends to play further away from the goal as the pockets of space he operates in don't make him a goal threat, and that's what Everton have missed out in. But in the team tonight, when you've got Calvert-Lewin and Richarlison in the side, that you know, you're looking at a good bit of link-up play to bring them goals.
Mm. A player that I know you've been impressed by, especially in the last round against Salford, Niels Nkunku. What are you most looking forward to about seeing from his performance then?
Oh, he was terrific in that game against Salford. First time I'd really had the opportunity to see him live, but his ability, his skill, his pace, his decision-making, I thought was first class. He really did offer something down that left-hand side. And Luca Dean has obviously become Everton's first-choice left-back. Leighton Baines retired over the summer, and you wonder how Everton are going to find someone to back up Luca Dean. Well, this player could back up and more. He really does have the ability to become a top-class left-back under the tutelage of Carlo Ancelotti.
These are perfect games, Jamie, for players to show Carlo Ancelotti just what they can do to get somewhere near that Premier League.
Yeah, absolutely. And a link-up with Anthony Gordon, and we were both saying that before the game, I was looking forward to watching him. Mm. He's obviously not picked him today, and he's gone with Richarlison, which is, he's a top-class player. But I'd like to have seen Gordon play today. I really like the way he plays, enthusiasm and great skill and pace. I'm sure we'll see him at some stage in the game.
OK, that's the Everton side of the equation going into the fixture here at Highbury this evening. The home team, Fleetwood Town, of course, coming to it ready and able. Don't know who your money would be on in that particular match-up between the two there. Deep in conversation. Hopefully, he'll have plenty to say after the break when we catch up with Joey Bart. That's his posse for tonight. Mine's Leon Osman and Jamie Redknapp, who we'll get more from in just a second. But first, the thoughts of Joey Barton now with David Craig.
Joey, it's well documented, your love affair with Everton. So how special occasion is this for you tonight to face them in this competition?
Yeah, first time I've faced them on the managerial side. I played the 23s last year in the Chequer trade, which was a good experience going to Goodison Park. So obviously one of the top managers in the world in the hot seat now at Goodison and really looking forward to the challenge tonight.
Just one change in your lineup. Morgan Boys, who's on loan from Liverpool. How much faith do you place him in this evening?
Yeah, we've got a young back line. I think I've got a 19-year-old in Boise, James Hill, 18, alongside him, and Sam Stubbs, who's 21. So really, really young back line. It's great to see they've picked Richarlison and Dominic Calvert-Lewin because it'll give them the challenge that we're looking to get for those boys to add to the experience that they can use on later in their career.
So just about 2.5 years in charge for Joey Barton at Fleetwood. He has improved Fleetwood year on year and sixth place at the end of last season in League One. Second highest finish in Fleetwood's history. Jamie, for a fledgling manager, he's done a terrific job, isn't he?
Yeah, really good job. I played against him, met him a few times, and you knew he was a student of the game. And I think when you get into management, you never quite know how it's going to go with somebody. You know, he's had an interesting career at times. But I think sometimes those experiences will probably help him because he understands what it's like with the players and what you have to deal with and the certain things that come your way. And he really is doing a good job. I think he's got a good chairman there, lovely stadium, and everything is in a good position for someone like a young manager like to work in. So there's so much you can do with that club.
And given the fixture this evening, that free hit element, I mean, I get the sense that Joey Barton will be taking this as serious as he possibly could, wouldn't he?
Absolutely. They've played a strong team in every game this season. Not many changes, whether it be in the previous ties that they've played. They've been involved in some very exciting games as well. They've scored and conceded in every goal, which, for our point of view, hope continues. And he's had faith in a really young back three. All three players combined, age 58 years old, which is incredible.
You played with Stubbs.
Yes, a friend of mine, son Sam Stubbs, I've seen him develop since he was 10 years old. So it's great to see that they've really developed as players and that
is he a similar player to his dad?
He is. He'll be prepared to get on the ball. He's in. We expect him to be in the middle of the back three tonight. Don't be surprised to see him trying to play crossfield passes. And,
his dad could play that. His dad loved that ping, didn't he?
Well,
he could play his dad.
An argument, a competition about who did it better. So we'll have a look tonight.
Yeah,
gents, you've got plenty of time to chat as the game goes on. I've got to get to the commentary team.
Sorry, mate.
Steve Hendry and first Gary Weaver.
Yes, thank you, David. Well, let's get straight down to the team news. And Fleetwood Town have got a blend of youth and experience in their team. The youth is at the back, where they have two teenagers, as well as 21-year-old Sam Stubbs, whose dad, Alan, is Everton royalty. Sam himself is an Evertonian. Alongside him is 18-year-old James Hill, who's already attracting attention from Premier League clubs, while 19-year-old Morgan Boys is on loan from Liverpool. The experience is in front of that back line in Paul Coutts and Glenn Whelan. Another experienced player and a scouser, Mark Duffy, is amongst Fleetwood Town substitutes. Well, Everton have gone stronger than many here expected. Dominic Calvert-Lewin leads the attack, fresh from scoring a hat-trick on Saturday. Richarlison also forms part of that front three. Fabian Delph and Alex Iwobi are both back fit, and they start here. Niels Nkunku was outstanding against Salford at Goodison last week. He starts at left-back, with Luca Dinia again operating at centre-back. James Rodriguez is not involved at all. Well, time was on nights like this that Merseyside teams on the guest list were established non-league names like Prescott Cables, like Marine and South Liverpool. But tonight, Fleetwood Town roll out the red carpet for the biggest club they've ever faced in a competitive game in their history. The famous name of Everton walking onto Fleetwood soil in what is one of the biggest, if not the biggest, nights in Fleetwood Town's history. Which just over a decade ago had some of their peers laughing at them when they said they were aiming to rise to the then conference, and now dreaming of bringing down a Premier League club here tonight. And Joey Barton, a boyhood Evertonian, hoping, Lee Hendry, that he can plot their downfall.
Yeah, certainly, and I think, you know, you look at the side that's been put out from Carlo Ancelotti, and it's a big statement, isn't it? It really is. And some great evening for some of these youngsters. We've looked at the heart of the defence. Lots of young boys back there that are coming up against an informed Calvert-Lewin, who's been absolutely magnificent come the start of the season. He'll still want to continue his flurry of goals.
It will be Fleetwood Town to get us underway in this third round Carabao Cup tie at Highbury. Both teams take the knee. No room for racism in society. So just over a decade ago, Fleetwood Town were not even dreaming of nights like this. They never thought they'd have nights like this, but this club has come so far in a short space of time. They were knocking on the championship door last season. Just missed out in the playoffs on promotion to the second tier, but tonight they host a strong Everton team. Everton looking to write happier memories in this particular tournament, the League Cup, which they've never won. One of English football's most decorated clubs have never walked off with this particular trophy, but we've seen from the team selection, Lee, that Carlo Ancelotti means business here.
Yeah, and why shouldn't he? This is a great opportunity to go and get a trophy. I think with the side he's put out this evening, there'll be a few that'll be disappointed that they're not in the previous round. Fantastic performance against Salford, but that's the manager's choice, and the guys that have been put out against a super squad. You look at the strength and depth that Everton have this season, and they really are a force, they really are.
As Niels Nkunku made such an impression against Salford City at Goodison last week. A player that's cost Everton around about £250,000 in compensation that they've had to pay to Marseille.
I think that's where it's going to be the threat this evening. Certainly, he's going to be a lot down his left-hand side. Wes Burns will have it all to do. Richarlison will be direct. And Kuku will certainly go and join in like he did in that previous round.
Returning Fabian Delph, his first game since February. Luca Dinia bringing the ball out from the back. There's Nkunku playing in Luca Dinia's position. Michael Keane. That's Keane again. Fleetwood happy to back off for now. Jerry Barton doesn't expect his Fleetwood team to play Everton at their own game tonight. He's looking forward, though, to seeing how his players execute their tactical plan. The plan that they've come up with to try and stop Everton.
I think already you can see it's almost a 5-4-1 formation. You can see they're just getting bodies behind the ball. Chet Evans is certainly leading the line. And they're looking to counter-attack as much as possible because Everton will throw bodies forward. And they've got to break down this wall of Fleetwood. Experienced midfielders in there. Paul Coutts and Glenn Whelan.
Yeah, you can see there Glenn Whelan just taking charge of the situation, but it gets beyond Wes Burns. There's Delph. Now Keane, who came back strong after the restart. Arguably Everton's best performer after the restart last season, and he's started this season in the same manner. Luca Dinia. There's Nkunku. Now Richarlison. That was noticeable about Everton against Salford last week was that Anthony Gordon, when he was playing on the left-hand side, was moving infield and Nkunku was operating in the space that he had left. That's how they caused Salford problems down the left-hand side. 48% of Everton's attacks came down the left last week against Salford, as opposed to 13% down the right. Here they come down the left again with Richarlison, and it's dealt with well by Morgan Boys.
Yeah, I do feel that worked so well against Salford. I just felt that having that room to go into, and Kuku certainly was a big effect, wasn't he? Got really far forward, got some great delivery into the box. And it might be a little bit different this evening. Richarlison does like to hook the touchline. He does like the ball to his feet.
It was Nkunku who moved in field that time. So we'll be back in the frame tonight for Everton, one of those who will be fighting for his place now after the signings that Everton have made in the summer. James Rodriguez not involved at all here tonight, but his mere presence has lifted the quality in training. His teammates can't wait to train with him every day.
It's a magnificent sign. I think, you know, when you've got someone of his quality, and I think there were question marks whether he was going to come in and do what he's done, but he's hit the ground running. And I think, you know, you've also got to single out Decore Allen, who's come in. He's been absolutely instrumental in that midfield, and all of a sudden we're seeing Calvert-Lewin absolutely at top form. This is a great opportunity for this season to go and get a hat full of goals.
Lovely ball from Keane to Richarlison, who claims handball, but the referee, who tonight is Jeremy Simpson, is not interested in the appeals.
We've seen quite a few of these over the weekend, in particular, arms away. It's clear that his arms are certainly away from his body. It's his blatant handball.
Paul Coutts gets away with it. Here come Everton again with Bernard. Now Gylfi Sigurdsson. John Joe Kenny will pick up the baton. There's Delph. Would have lost just two of their last 19 games. It's a run which took them into the playoffs last season. And ultimately, they fell against Wickham. The cross by Nkunku, and Calvert-Lewin flung himself at it. Couldn't really make contact.
Well, I'll tell you what, that's the difference this season to last season with Calvert-Lewin. Times we'd see him drifting out in these wide areas. This time it's Nkunku, puts an absolute special cross into that six-yard area, and Calvert-Lewin's inches away from getting on the score sheet. That's what you want from Calvert-Lewin, and certainly Carlo Ancelotti wants from him.
Yeah, the Everton manager has told Dominic Calvert-Lewin to stay within the width of the penalty area more and work on his one-touch finishing. He was right in the box there, but couldn't finish with that one-touch as the ball just whizzed past him.
And I think that's so important, Gary, that when you're playing that centre forward role, you've got to stay in between the lines.
Iwobi's ball in this time. Fleetwood Town just about standing their ground, but Everton are asking questions, and they're asking a question of the referee. There's Wheeler. Now Burns. It's Alex Kearns dealing with that. He was Fleetwood's number one last season, but he hasn't been this because Joel Coleman was brought in, but he's since been injured. So Alex Kearns has got his place back for now. Challenged there by Fabian Delph, who stays down.
It's an excellent challenge as well, because Morris just peels away from him. Delph just being clever, getting his body in front. It's an excellent tackle in the box, has to get it right. He just catches one, and a late one off Morris himself.
He's had a calf problem, Fabian Delph, then had a setback in pre-season training, but tonight he starts for Everton as the rain continues to fall in Highbury. Fleetwood Town have a corner and a chance to put the pressure on Everton. It's rolled to Morris, a high hanging cross. Keane takes charge. Bernard looking to lead the breakout for the visitors. There's Fabian Delph. Now Sigurdsson. Iwobi. Nice idea, but well spotted by Morgan Boys on loan here from Liverpool, the left-sided centre-back.
They really started the game well. Everton have lots of possession of the ball. Like the way they're moving the ball very quickly, trying to get in areas, trying to break Fleetwood down.
Gylfi Sigurdsson. Well, Carlo Ancelotti will say he doesn't want his teams to knock the ball around the back. He wants them to pass with purpose and try and play direct if they have to. And attack quickly, and Jerry Barton will know what he's up against here tonight. Sigurdsson. There's Nkunku. Now Bernard. No stranger to playing in that central position. There's Bernard. Luca Digne. Coming through towards Gylfi Sigurdsson, but he got away from him. There's the calm head of Glenn Whelan, who moved here from Hearts. Now Chet Evans. This is Coutts. Now Burns. Coutts again, who helped Sheffield United from League One to the Premier League. Burns with the ball in. Bernard. Alex Iwobi. Kenny goes for the return. Calvert-Lewin's in the middle.
That's twice in a matter of minutes that Kenny's made that run. Iwobi does well to create the space, draw two players in, and it's just a poor pass out to him.
Bernard, plenty of space to run into. Nkunku. He's outwitted Burns, he's lifted another good ball in. And again, Calvert-Lewin was lurking at the far post.
Well, I tell you what, this boy's certainly got some talent. He's so direct, I love it. He's got plenty of pace and delivery has been first class yet again. Calvert-Lewin could have easily had two. Super balls in the box.
Well, the feeling was at Marseille, they did offer him a professional contract, but he didn't think he'd get enough game time there, which is why he made the switch to Everton this summer, because the feeling at Marseille was maybe he wasn't ready to mix it with the first team at the Stade Vélodrome just yet. And he knew that, and that's why he headed out to Everton. Juventus and RB Leipzig came to the table quite late as well to try and take him.
You just wonder this evening, and pairing up with Richarlison, is he going to be not far away from playing the Premier League? Because he certainly could fit the bill.
Jonjo Kenny, Iwobi. Kenny again, playing by Alex Kearns in the Fleetwood goal. But this was the kind of start that Joey Barton was expecting here tonight. Everton to see plenty of the ball and looking for his team to dig their heels in and stand their ground.
And I think that's one thing that's important this evening for Joey Barton, and that's in particular what I've been impressed with over the past few seasons. He's putting his star, his philosophy on things. You know, defensively, he wants to start games well. And you're coming up against a tough Premier League outfit. And I feel that they've started the game well. You know, that's one thing that they will do. They will allow Everton to have plenty of the ball. But when they win the ball back, they've got to keep and retain possession of the ball as much as possible and counter-attack how they normally do.
Richarlison, faced by Burns, moves away from Burns, having a difficult old time on the right-hand side defensively for Fleetwood. Good start out as a striker, Wes Burns. He's been a winger as well, operating at wing-back here tonight, but he's been playing at right-back for Fleetwood.
I bet he wishes he was playing striker tonight.
Nkunku and Richarlison looking to cause problems for him again. Given away by Bernard. This is Fabian Delph. Gylfi Sigurdsson. Coots helping out and Hill intervening, and that is Whelan. And Fleetwood move the ball nicely to get themselves out of a tight spot. Callum Camps was screaming for the ball through the middle there, the former Rochdale man, but Fleetwood Town went back instead.
I think just what we expected, plenty of possession for Everton in these opening stages, plenty of the ball. Joey Barton would certainly have expected that from the away side.
Luca Digne. This is Bernard. Looking for some movement, he's tried to pick out Calvert-Lewin. Bernard again, this is Gylfi Sigurdsson. Clean challenge by Glenn Whelan, that's what he does in front of the back line.
He certainly does, and that's why he's put in that position, to try and protect that back three at times. And Paul Coots will certainly do that. And they won't be shy of putting their foot in.
Some problems for Everton here as Andrew took the throw in, looking for Callum Camps. We do have the weapon of long throws of James Hill, the teenager, but they didn't fancy using it there. I'm told he could throw it to Blackpool from here. There's Keane. Michael Keane to break the line for that pass to Dominic Calvert-Lewin, who was caught, and Everton have a free kick.
Yeah, they've almost got every man behind the ball, Fleetwood, just making it hard to break them little lines. I think that's when we need to see Bernard certainly dropping into them little pockets. Delph and Sigurdsson certainly find that pass.
Used to be a midfielder, Dominic Calvert-Lewin. He was moved up front of Sheffield United by Nigel Clough, who threw him on in a game as a striker, and he's not been back to midfield since.
He certainly impressed me this season, in particular how he started. Certainly with the new signings, I think they've been a massive help.
Lucadinha having a look at this for Everton. Gylfi Sigurdsson on the scene as well. It's Lucadinha. Now Bernard. Iwobi looking to measure the cross. Iwobi again, moving away from Evans. Bernard. And Kunku is on his way again. He's delivered the cross again. Fleetwood Town somehow have to try and shut him down.
Yeah, he's absolutely excellent. He just wants to get that ball out of his feet, and he's not even, doesn't have to look into an area. He's just putting it at pace. I'm just hoping someone's going to get across that near post.
Paul Coutts just gets away from Burns. This is the furthest that Fleetwood Town have gone in the League Cup. This round three tonight, they've beaten Wigan and beaten Port Vale, both here at Highbury so far. But they're on the back foot here. Richarlison. Bernard. Richarlison again. Gylfi Sigurdsson. Now Jonjo Kenny. Kenny Calvert-Lewin tried to smuggle it back towards Kenny. This is Chet Evans. It will have to be Fleetwood's out ball here tonight.
Yeah, Wilbin is dropping into them. Centre-forward midfield role. It'll be very difficult for him tonight. Needs a service, he needs to protect it so bodies can climb up the pitch and leave a bit of pressure.
Josh Morris caught by Fabian Delph. Kunku. His brother William is a player as well. He's played in the lower leagues in France. A right back, 23 years of age. His brother looking for a club. He's currently living with Niels in Liverpool. It was loose. It put Lucadine in trouble, but Lucadine got out of a corner. Fabian Delph. Bernard looking to make things happen again for Everton. Off the head of Sam Stubbs. Richarlison. Kunku's on the outside. Richarlison goes infield this time. It's Gylfi Sigurdsson. Trying to poke it through to Richarlison, and Burns did well, and Whelan finds Kearns. He tries to get Fleetwood up the pitch, but Everton are coming at them again.
Yeah, they are. 20 minutes in and you feel that they've defended reasonably well. It's going to find it hard to break that line so bad.
Iwobi! Took a deflection and strikes the crossbar.
And that's just the change of play. Rather than trying to break them lines, Iwobi just drifting in from that right-hand side. I think takes a little deflection off Glenn Whelan as he strikes it. Certainly got Alex Cairns beaten. It just dips on the top of the bar. Excellent effort.
Glenn Whelan is keeping a watch on Dominic Calvert-Lewin. Plenty of movement in the box, and Calvert-Lewin still managed to get to it, despite being watched by two Fleetwood players, one of which was Glenn Whelan. Going long. Had a one by Hill. There's Bernard. Bernard, lovely thinking, and the header finds the back of the net from Richarlison. Everton Everton have been making the headlines so far this season, but they're looking to stay out of them tonight by avoiding a shock, and that was beautifully constructed.
Yeah, and it really was, and you just feel that, I was just about to say, Jordan Pickford hasn't touched the ball, and it's a long strike up to Calvert-Lewin. And I think Jamie said about Bernard just drifting into that more central area where he's more dangerous and effective, and he puts a delightful ball over the back three, and you just see Richarlison timing his run perfection and heading back towards that far corner. Alex Cairns getting no chance, zips off the surface. Excellent finish by Richarlison.
Well, Bernard does like playing further in field. He feels he can influence the game more in a central position. He has played this role in his career before, but he's better known as a winger.
Yeah, but I mean, you just look at the way Everton's set up, and obviously there's got to be that movement in their more central areas, especially if you want Calvert-Lewin playing predominantly between the lines through the goal. You've got the wide men who can put delivery in, and if you've got that number 10 who can sit in the pockets, certainly effective.
Wes Burns scampering back and managing to cut off that supply line from Richarlison to Nkunku. It's been a good opening quarter of this contest by Everton, who are playing with a spring in their step. They're playing with a swagger here.
Well, I did like what Carlo Ancelotti said in previous the game, just saying the momentum's there at the moment. That's why there hasn't been loads of changes. There's players that are playing well. I like the fact of that, especially when you look at Calvert-Lewin who's scoring goals. He'll want to continue that.
He's not here to mess about tonight, Carlo Ancelotti. We've seen that from the team selection. He's not at Everton to mess about either. He wants to win a trophy and finish in the European places in the Premier League. That's the target for Everton this season. Gylfi Sigurdsson looking for the movement on the far side of John Joe Kenny. Boys is across on the cover.
There's good cover, and again, the wide areas have been so effective so far. John Joe Kenny just making that direct run. He will be not making the movement. It's hard to pick up.
Bernard standing right in front of Alex Cairns in that Fleetwood goal. Lucadinia with the high-hanging corner. Calvert-Lewin peeled away and got his head onto it. There's Delph. Loose from Delph, who then commits the foul on Morris.
I think you class that as a very, very good foul. He's claiming he hasn't touched Morris as he's got away, but clear as day as he's just took a bad touch. I think there was a little tug on Morris's shirt. Branded the yellow card.
Well, he had to take evasive action there to make sure that that didn't develop any further for Fleetwood. Paul Coutts with a free kick. Alex Iwobi. Stopped in his tracks by Glenn Whelan. There's Nkunku. Now John Joe Kenny. Ball in, and it's dealt with by James Hill, the 18-year-old, who's attracting attention from Premier League clubs already, the Fleetwood centre-back, but Andy Pilley, the Fleetwood owner, told me yesterday it's far too early for them to sell him to a Premier League club at the moment. Andy Pilley, who's been owner here since 2004, when Fleetwood were five levels below, the EFL. When he first walked into the stadium, it was a little bit different than this. He opened a window and it fell out. Times have changed.
Well, you do feel that Fleetwood are certainly going in the right direction under Joey Barton. Bringing some good players, young players. That's what I like.
Yeah, they have a £10 million training ground as well. They're about to invest another £1 million into that to build an indoor dome to take their academy from Category 3 status to Category 2. Big plans for Fleetwood Town. But as for the here and now, they're up against a Premier League team, Everton, who started this game really well.
They've absolutely been magnificent, 27 minutes in, and it just looks like there's a real big buzz in this Everton side. Lots of players on show trying to stake a claim. Big things are coming at Everton.
Stubbs getting to that. His dad Alan is watching on the TV tonight. There's Fabian Delph. He won't be fazed by this, Sam Stubbs. He's faced the likes of Rangers, of Celtic, of PSV as well. Been out on loan at Den Haag and Hamilton. There's Iwobi. The goal scorer, Richarlison. There's Nkunku. Iwobi again. Iwobi, Richarlison sticks out a boot. The boys feared the worst and dealt with it. Jonjo Kenny. Lucadinha. This is Kenny, back from a season-long loan at Schalke. He'll be happy he avoided their 8-0 hammering by Bayern Munich last week. There's Nkunku. Another cross delivered from Niels Nkunku. Bernard Iwobi turns away from trouble, gets the shot away. It's just wide of Kern's right post.
And again, Bernard picking up the pieces from that left-hand side. Crossed in, and Nkunku comes back out. He's looking for a little 1-2. Iwobi does so well just to shape up. And inches away from hitting the target. Half a yard, just drags his shot wide. Forward play from Everton's been absolutely magnificent today, really good. Wide areas have been superb. Well, that speaks for itself, it really does. Five attempts to Fleetwood zero, and the one attempt has led to Everton being 1-0.
Yeah, Richarlison, the man who struck. Well, can struck a goal as well. Lovely ball from Bernard to pick him out. So it does go the way of Everton, whose appeals were the loudest. Iwobi. Everton were a team going nowhere last season, and after the final game of the season, which ended in defeat by Bournemouth, Carlo Ancelotti told his players to go away and come back with more ambition and more motivation. He looks to have added ambition and bite to his Everton squad in the summer, particularly in the midfield, an area that they had to improve in. Glenn Whelan. Bernard picks up for Everton. It's Bernard! So close to making it two.
Yeah, absolutely magnificent from Bernard. And you just look at the press, the high press, the intensity. that Everton have gone about their business in this first half, and this is where it leads to Bernard getting the pieces. It looked like he's going to shape up to hit it with his right. Clever little Cruyff turn onto the left, and it's a little bender right in that far corner that nearly edges in. Excellent play.
And he's just left his calling card with Josh Morris. He's back at Fleetwood for a second spell, being headed off to Scunthorpe. Scored 10 goals last season. Fleetwood are looking for more goals from the central midfield areas this season. Joey Barton thinks it'll take around about 80 goals to get them out of this league this time around. It's normally a goal a point if you look at the table at the end of the season. The ambition for Sam Stubbs and co is to get out of League One this season and into the Championship and be one league below Everton.
They were very unfortunate last season, making the playoffs and just didn't turn out.
That's Bernard. Now Keane. Here goes Kenny again. Iwobi. Now Fabian Delph. First ball has picked up Richarlison, who brings it under his spell. Richarlison, Iwobi, nicely done, Richarlison! It's another beautiful goal from Everton. He was Everton's main man last season, Richarlison, and he's doing the business again.
And I'll tell you what, this is a fabulous goal. I can't wait to see it again, actually. The build-up play to it is absolutely spot-on, coming from right over to that big switch which Richarlison's in. Just looking at Bernard's position again. Look at the run he makes. Burst pass, bringing players out of the game. And look at this 1-2. It's absolutely excellent. Follows his pass. Great little back heel from Iwobi into Richarlison's pass. They're just oozing with confidence and class at the moment. It's a super. Anything on it, a little bit of a toe punt. Straight at the goal. No chance for Alex Kearns again as it comes at pace. Excellent build-up play.
Sinking feeling for Joey Barton. He knew this potentially could be a tough night. It could get even tougher here as they've turned the ball over again.
I think Joey Barton will be disappointed at times where they've given the ball away too cheaply, especially how much possession Everton have had. They're literally chasing the ball, and when they're getting it back, it's going back too easy. It'll be a long goal night.
Yeah, they lost a few big characters from that team which made it to the playoffs last season in Fleetwood Town. Such is the way of life in League One. Joey Barton still looking for four new players to come in and come straight into the starting 11. But the defence has had to be changed around from last season. Louis Coyle went to Hull. Lewis Gibson, who was on loan here from Everton, went back to Goodison. Harry Souter as well, he went back to Stoke. So they've had to make changes at the back, and it's a team which is still settling in at the moment, but they've been unsettled by this Everton side.
And I think that's the story really in League One. You know, you're having to bring players in hoping that it's going to gel and work straight away, which it has to some extent. You look at how they've started the campaign and they've been superb. They're coming up against a very, very strong Everton side here. You've got to take that into consideration.
Yeah, he was expecting six tough games, he said, at the start of the season because of the changes they've had to make. But they started well up until this tonight. They were beaten at Peterborough on the weekend. They conceded two late goals in stoppage time. There's Nkunku again looking to cause problems down the left-hand side and put behind, no messing about, by Sam Stubbs.
Yeah, good defending. So difficult with what they offer out wide. Nkunku again wanting to face his marker up and get by at pace, which he's done so well in this first half again.
The signal from Gylfi Sigurdsson. Johnson having a look at the referee as he hit the deck. There's Luka Dinja. Gylfi Sigurdsson again. Nkunku. There's Bernard. He did create the most chances in that win against Salford last week, Bernard. And he's been at the heart of everything again for Everton so far tonight.
Yeah, he has. He's, at times he's drifted out wide into this left area where he does like to cut in and go and play as the central striker, but he's been everywhere so far this evening. In fact, most of the Everton players have. The movement's been absolutely superb all over the pitch.
I saw John Joe Kenny making that move there, which was seen by Dinja. That's Fabian Dell, first for Charleston again. And Kunku's on the outside, and Kunku, another dangerous ball in again. They just cannot stop him.
Well, if I was Calvert-Lewin, I'd just be standing around that six-yard area trying to get anything that comes across, because there's nothing in Nkunku's mind but to just flash that ball across the box. Time and time again, he's done it at pace. It's a striker's dream.
Emerson on the front foot again. It's Jonjo Kenny that time.
And I think he chose the wrong option here. Jonjo Kenny just opens up for him, and you can just see Bernard on the edge of the box, where he can just lay it to him to come on and hit that first time, but chooses to go alone. Certainly opens up for him here. You can just see Bernard on the edge of the box, no one on him. Easy decision, head in hands. And it's high and wide. I would say that's a fullback shot, but I've seen fullbacks put him in the top corner.
Yeah, fullbacks game these days. More live Carabao Cup action to come tomorrow. Lincoln City against Liverpool. See you tomorrow, 7:30 on Sky Sports Football. James Hill intervening again. His dad Matty Hill was part of the Sheffield United squad who made an impact in the Cups, the FA Cup, 6 years ago when they made it to the semi-finals as a League One club. The time when Sheffield United were trapped in League One, finally made their way out of it under Chris Wilder. And they're now rubbing shoulders with English football royalty in the Premier League. And the Premier League's the target for this Fleetwood Town team to reach in the next few years. There's Iwobi, seen off by Stubbs. Certainly as a club, that's the ambition at Fleetwood Town under owner Andy Pilley, who's taken them, as we said before, from five tiers below the EFL into League One, knocking on the championship door. He thinks they can win promotion to the second tier and then go again. It would be some achievement if they were to achieve that. Kunku. That's Delph. This is Keane. Jonjo Kenny. Born an Evertonian, he says, used to be a season ticket holder at Goodison Park. His family were all Evertonians. He was on the pitch as a fan back in 1994 when Everton secured Premier League survival on the last day. He raced onto the pitch in celebration with the thousands of other Everton fans. And he left the stadium with a piece of that pitch as well as a souvenir. Facing them as a manager for the first time.
I think he'd be impressed with what he's seen from this Everton side for sure. And I think you just got to look at the young experience. This is for some of these boys, you know, Morgan Boyce, Sam Stubbs, James Hill. It's massive for them tonight. It really is. And you've got to give Joey a lot of credit. Putting young boys into a team against some fabulous talent that's on show this evening. It's a great experience, it really is.
Sigurdsson's free kick. It was met by Sam Stubbs. John Joe Kenny. Such an aggressive attacking fullback. His opportunities limited under Marco Silva, which is why he did head out on loan to Schalke in the Bundesliga last season. He made a really big impression there.
So impressed with them, the pass accuracy, 93%. I think that just shows just the edge that's shown on Everton this evening. It really has. They've kept the ball so well. You know, you look at it, and I was almost thinking, I don't think they've really given the ball away in too many areas. And 93%, it's a big possession. It really is. And it isn't just that they've kept the ball needlessly, they've been effective going forward, they've tried to break the lines. Very impressive.
Yeah, as we said earlier, that's how Carlo Ancelotti wants to play. He's not interested in possession for possession's sake. If they can go direct, go direct. If they can break the lines, break the lines. Side Carlo Ancelotti lives in Crosby, takes his bike out on the trail from Crosby to Southport. Jurgen Klopp doesn't live too far away from him. As we said earlier on, he's at Everton to win trophies and to be successful. He feels he's building a squad that can do just that. Luca Digne. To one additional minute at the end of the first half. There's Iwobi. And Kunku. On the Calvert-Lewin in the target. Target found. Good save from Kearns. He was there to greet Dominic Calvert-Lewin. And he keeps Fleetwood Town in the Carabao Cup for now.
It's a great save as well from Alex Kearns. Excellent ball into Calvert-Lewin, super first touch as well. I thought he was going to stick it in the back of the net.
Well, he was devastated with his performance in the playoff first leg against Wickham here last season, Alex Kearns. He lost the number one spot, lost the number one shirt as well, but that's a big, big save.
Yeah, it really is, and it's a great ball. And you just think to yourself, who's he going to keep that, which he does so well, super strike.
Everton, the dominant force in the first half at Highbury. Richarlison with a double. They have been strutting their stuff on this Highbury pitch, painting their patterns on the Highbury canvas. Fleetwood Town don't have an answer at the break. Fleetwood 0, Everton 2.
So he's been looking enviously on as Dominic Calvert-Lewin has grabbed all the headlines so far this season. But Richarlison has scored his first goals of the campaign for Everton. Ben Osmond, Jimmy Redknapp alongside me here in the studio. He looks like he's got the bit between his teeth tonight, doesn't he? And kicked it all off after 22 minutes, Leon.
He does. He really felt, you felt, he feels like he was missing out. You know, all the talk had been about James, all the talk had been about Dominic Calvert-Lewin in the opening few games. And you could see that look in his eye tonight. Every time he was anywhere near the goal, you felt he had an opportunity to score. He's actually flipped over to the opposite side of the field on this occasion. The fluidity of Everton's possession and movement today has been fantastic.
Perfectly timed run as well from Richarlison for you.
Perfectly timed. Bernard in those pockets Jamie was talking about earlier, and when he gets in those positions, you just don't expect him to miss. It was a terrific opening 22 minutes from Everton, completely dominated the game and led to the opening goal.
Happy enough with Carlo Ancelotti's approach from his side in the first half, Jamie. Exemplified there, of course, by Richarlison getting on the score sheet. He didn't have to wait too long, did he, for his second?
No, he's a man full of confidence in the second goal. That was a great header. This is a lovely piece of play. Good switch. And then once he gets that ball, he's trying to get that ball onto his right foot. Cuts inside, and the bit I like most about it is a little drag. It looks like he's running into a bit of a cul-de-sac. He drags it with his left foot, plays a 1-2 with Iwobi. And it's class. It just sums up how good Everton have been. The football's been exquisite. They play with pace. In a game that I thought they might have problems with, they've made it look so easy. And it's a good finish as well. Look, just toe poke past the goalkeeper. And this is a player that he's got all the attributes. He's a powerful boy, good in the air, intelligent, plays off either side. So many goals in his armoury. And I think playing off those wide areas suits him to a certain extent. It's like playing up front, you're up against two defenders. When he moves around like that, Leon, he's so difficult to stop.
He is, and Everton have real options when he does that. As you said, we've seen him play up front alongside Dominic Calvert-Lewin towards the end of last season, and now playing out on that left-hand side, we've seen him popping up on the right-hand side. He has an opportunity really to drift into spaces he feels are most dangerous, and when you've got a player with, as you mentioned, that bit between his teeth, that real determination to get his name back in the scoring limelight, you're seeing the performance that we have done tonight.
Well, Leon mentions options. It's £210 million worth of options. That many that I can't say it. Jamie, from Everton's point of view, could they have put the game to bed in the first half?
They've had so many good chances. I mean, they've had 79% possession. They've been so in control in this game. You feel a little bit sorry for Fleetwood because it's just a huge golfing class. They haven't got the crowd there to help them, to push them on, to make challenges. And Kuku down the left-hand side has crossed the board to so many good areas. And Bernard playing central has been incredible as well. And Iwobi getting strikes away, staking a claim, because obviously everyone now is full of confidence. This is a team you want to be in right now, and they're just really enjoying their football.
I think Carlo Ancelotti will be most pleased. You know, he's got six players who've come in that didn't feature at the weekend. Those players aren't in there just trying to get their match fitness. Those players are in there trying to prove to the manager that they should be in and around his team. They should be in his thoughts moving forward. And if he's going to make changes, they have to be at that level, and every player has been tonight.
So, Everton in total control of this tie at Highbury Stadium in Fleetwood. Carlo Ancelotti put the big guns in, and they've rewarded him so far. A huge 45 minutes coming up for Fleetwood. Changes afoot at the Highbury Stadium. With news of those, your commentary team, Lee Hendry and Gary Weaver.
Yes, thank you, David. Anthony Gordon has come on for Everton at half-time. And Mark Duffy was being readied at the break. Looks like he's come on too for Fleetwood Town. Scouser would have played at Fleetwood in his non-league days with Prescott Cables and Southport. Liverpool fan. So Mark Duffy is on for Fleetwood Town. Anthony Gordon is on for Everton. Fleetwood with it all to do in this second 45, Everton will look to continue where they left off. There's Iwobi. Iwobi wanted it back, but not quite there.
I think Carlo Ancelotti will certainly want the same sort of pace and energy Everton possessed in that first half. Joey Barton will certainly change the system and formation. Obviously with Duffy coming on.
Well, he wants one aggression in the second half, Joey Barton from his Fleetwood Town team. If they can, they didn't lay a glove on Everton in that first 45. There's Duffy. Morris turning into a little bit of space.
That's good play from Fleetwood as well. just getting it out wide, obviously pushing bodies more forward. Morris just picking the ball up, trying to pick out. I think it was Boyce at the back.
Confirmation then that Anthony Gordon's replaced Dominic Calvert-Lewin, while Mark Duffy has come on for Sam Stubbs, as Jordan Pickford's put under pressure. And Duffy scores! Straight into the action, the Scouser, the Liverpool fan, has just put Fleetwood Town back in the conversation against Everton.
Well, it's game on, and all eyes will be on Jordan Pickford, trying to play out from the back here, trying to be a little bit too cute, getting shut down, as you can see there, by Morris, and it just comes out to Duffy. He's probably had two touches since he's been on, still got it all to do. But it's a gift given to him, and he's still got to stick it past Pickford, which he does nicely, and brought his side, Fleetwood, back into this game.
Well, that's the start that Joey Barton would have wanted his Fleetwood Town team to make right at the start of this second half. All they could do in the first half was just watch and admire Everton, but they have come to the party in the second 45, and Mark Duffy has struck, and that will encourage them.
Yeah, it certainly will, and they're just playing higher up the pitch, and you see Morris has pushed further on, Camps has further on, just so Jed Evans has got a lot more support when it gets into their more final areas. But you do have to question mark Jordan Pickford in goal, got to be doing better, got to think sometimes you've got to clear your lines. All of a sudden, it is game on.
Mark Duffy's first goal for Fleetwood, his first goal since April 2019, and he scored for Sheffield United against Nottingham Forest in the Championship. Everton looking to respond. Richarlison, Iwobi! Everton do respond. Fleetwood Town are not back in this for long. Everton swat them away.
Yeah, and it's that young man Gordon who possibly thought he should have started this game. Straight away, he's made a big impact. We said he's been very direct in there. More wider areas, and he's come on straight away. Wouldn't say it's the most perfect cross, but Richarlison has half a chance, but he just faces his man up direct, swings that left foot back in. Richarlison misses it, and when you're in form and people are queuing up to score, Iwobi just lands on it, sweeps that left foot past Alex Cairns, makes it 3-1.
99 seconds between the two goals. Richarlison may well claim an assist for that. I know you would.
I certainly would.
Iwobi firing home.
That's the reaction you'd want from a mistake.
Out of play from Mark Duffy that time. Jordan Pickford punished at the start of the second half.
Yeah, we've seen it time and time again with goalkeepers, and I'm all for playing out from the back and in tight areas, but sometimes you've got to witness that there's bodies in and around, and it has got to go, whether it does look ugly. That was certainly a time where it did. After either going rose head or put it into a channel.
Breathe a huge sigh of relief that Everton went up the other end and scored a third. That's why Richarlison was feeling the pain.
It was a late one from Boyce, which catches Richarlison's trailing foot.
Here's Richarlison now playing through the middle since Dominic Calvert-Lewin was taken off at half-time. Just prefer to play there as a striker, Richarlison. Wes Burns. This is Mark Duffy. There's Duffy again. Duffy was on the books of Liverpool but was released as a teenager. He ended up being a scaffolder before making it back in to the professional game. He's committed the foul there.
He certainly made an impact since he's come on. Wants to get on the ball, wants to try and create, wants to try and make Fleetwood play as much as possible. That's what he will do, and that's what he'll add to this Fleetwood midfield.
And it was a shame the way it ended for him at Sheffield United. It was a big part of the rise from League One to the Premier League, but he was into the final year of his contract. He went to see Chris Wilder to ask what was going on, and I don't think Chris Wilder liked too much the tone of the meeting. So that was the end of Mark Duffy's time at Sheffield United, and Mark Duffy, by his own admission, felt he could have handled it better.
Wow, that is a big, big step. One in Fleetwood's box, which ended up resorting to the first goal. 22 for Everton in favour.
Goal from Mark Duffy, the one touch in Everton's box from a Fleetwood player so far. But we said earlier on they knew this could be a difficult night, but they're making a fight of it here. Chet Evans goes down, has a look at the referee, who moves away from the scene.
And he's got a good view on Chet Evans, and Luca Dina are obviously battling out. I certainly don't think it was a penalty. I think Glenn Whelan's arguing the case. It looked like Chet Evans actually slipped. I think it's a very good decision from the referee. Like I said, he had a good view from where he was stood.
But again, there we saw a bit more bite about this Fleetwood team, which will please their head coach.
I think sometimes you run the risk, sometimes you sit back and you try and soak up as much pressure as you can, but Everton were absolutely magnificent in that first half, and it was so hard to deal with the movement, the passing. And that's when you have to try and get yourself back in the game, and you know Joey Barton's not shy of changing his formation throughout a game. He's done it time and time again last season. I've seen him do it through the playoffs. The only way you're going to get back into games is if you're going to push bodies further up the pitch, give yourself a chance.
Change things around at half time here, bringing on Mark Duffy, creative force, and taking off centre back Sam Stubbs, which would have been a tough one for Sam Stubbs to take in terms of the opposition here tonight. As James Hill, who's being hunted down by Richarlison and being fouled by Richarlison.
Very lucky as well, because he does take a chance just trying to get by Richarlison. Didn't feel there was an awful lot in it.
There's Wheeler. Now Coots, Wheeler again. Here is Hill. Glenn Whelan, fired through to Morris. Fabian Delph got back goal side and won the ball back for Everton.
And they've just congested that midfield a little bit more. Fleetwood with Duffy coming in there. Got Coots and Whelan, making it a little bit more difficult for Delph, Sigerson, Bernard to get on the ball. We just felt that Everton have just been a little bit sloppy coming into this second phase.
Anthony Gordon, who's been in to see Carlo Ancelotti and asked why he hasn't been involved in the Premier League squad so far, and Carlo Ancelotti quite liked that about Anthony Gordon.
I love that, to be fair. That's showing that he feels that he should be a part of it.
Richarlison, Iwobi's there with him. It's Iwobi!
I'll tell you what, this is great play, great movement. And you've got to think, look at just a little bit of a run, how he burst past here, Richarlison, but Iwobi's run just holds it and delays. And the weight of pass from Richarlison's inch perfect for Iwobi just to come on and hit that first time. Unfortunately, can't hit the target.
It's Callum Camps, who hasn't seen too much of the ball so far tonight. Signed from Rochdale in the summer, brought to add goals in the midfield area to this Fleetwood Town team. As we said in the first half, it's something they felt they were lacking last season, which may just have got them over the line had they had it in that last campaign.
Yeah, well, he's one who certainly started the season well. Himself a couple of goals already. Be a big player for Fleetwood this season.
There's Duffy. No room here for Wheeler. Pickford thought about coming, now retreats. Comes to the middle. He gets his goal. And Fleetwood Town claw their way back into this again. Pickford angry with himself again. Fleetwood are not letting go.
Well, I wouldn't say it was Pele-like as in the overhead keep, but if you get anything on it, which he certainly does, it's a great build-up to the goal, though, really is. And look at the precision pass from Glenn Whelan, who picks out Chad Evans. It's just that little push on Luca Digne, just gives him half a yard. Still got an awful lot to do, but you hit the target with that little bit of a bicycle kick. And you can see Jordan Pickford just gets enough on it, but not enough to keep it out of goal. And Camps gets on the score sheet once again. Game on.
Jordan Pickford stuck his hand up. Must have thought that he would have kept that out, but he didn't.
Man, it was quite good pace that he generated from the bicycle kick. And it's a difficult one. You will feel that someone of Jordan Pickford's quality would have saved that, but lots of credit then. So bicycle kicks can go anywhere, and I think when you're off balance as a goalkeeper, difficult to grab hold or fist away, which seemed that case for Jordan Pickford then.
Well, just as we said that Callum Camps was brought to add goals from the midfield, he strikes. And that's his fourth goal of the season already. He struck eight last time for Rochdale, which was his most prolific campaign. But here come Fleetwood Town again. It's Morris, and Pickford keeps that one out. This is a different Fleetwood Town team in the second half.
It really is. It's a game of two halves, for sure. Everton gone off the ball, but I'm really pleased. And this is when I say it, you know, you've got to give credit to Joey Barton in the way he's changed his formation, changed the style, playing higher up the pitch, not allowing Everton to break the lines, not allowing them to have as much possession. Yes, they were chasing the game, but lots of credit to the way they've gone about their business this second half.
Yeah, the players who were effective for Everton in the first half, the likes of Bernard and Kunku, haven't really seen too much of the ball so far in the second 45.
I think sometimes you can play against the Premier League outfit and you can give them too much respect at times, and we do see this throughout football. The lower league teams are coming off against big names. I'm pretty sure Joey Barton would have stated that. Excellent strike again, coming from Morris, coming in from that right-hand side as well. I think what's been good, that the balls that have gone into Chad Evans, he's not going to bring it down. You know what you're getting from Chad Evans. He will put himself about, he will hustle and bustle, but he certainly needs people in and around him that can pick up the pieces. In that case, it was Morris who got the strike away.
It's not too comfortable now for Carlo Ancelotti.
Certainly will think that there will be question marks on Jordan Pickford. I think last season everyone stated he didn't have his greatest, but I do feel like he did start the campaign quite well. The two goals have gone in. Are they a little bit suspect to himself? Could he have saved the second one?
Fabian Delph's return is over for tonight, and Tom Davis replaces him at the heart of the Everton midfield. With a move to Southampton Tom Davis. Southampton still looking for a replacement for Pierre-Emile Højbjerg.
Tom Davis is another one. You do look at the strength and depth for Everton, and he stands out for me, he really does. I think this is a big season for him, whether it's at Everton, or this move does actually come off for Southampton.
Bernard, seen off. Tom Davis gets there just ahead of Jed Evans. Evans down, holding his knee. Anthony Gordon. Richarlison, Gylfi Sigurdsson, quite where Gylfi Sigurdsson wanted it. And Camps got in the way. Iwobi. Richarlison. Impeded there, Richarlison, but the referee wasn't too far away, wasn't interested. Jimmy Barton has been manager of Fleetwood for a couple of years now. He was training with them in 2012. They tried to sign him on loan. He was in dispute with Mark Hughes of Queen's Park Rangers at the time. Andy Kelly, the Fleetwood owner, stayed in touch with Joey Barton and offered them the main job here a couple of years ago. And he's found out that he's had to be a shoulder to cry on and lean on for players. He's had to be a nutritionist. He's had to do a lot more jobs as part of the head coach's job than he thought he'd have to do. There's Richarlison.
I think that might have been a big welcome to League One, Gary.
Certainly the way in Leagues 1 and League 2 as well. Talking to Simon Weaver last week at Harrogate Town, who's got a coaching staff of two or three around him, does his own video analysis. Joey Barton is enjoying life and learning on the job. And this is a big night for him against Carlo Ancelotti's Everton, and his team could easily have crumbled, but they haven't.
Yeah, they've showed character, and that's down to that man, it really is. Certainly a big character. I was going to tell you a story about my time at Bradford when I had a little spell. I took my kit off for training. I come back the next morning, it was still in the middle of the change room. I thought it was going to get washed by the kit man, but I was then told you have to take your own kit home and wash it.
Such is the way of life. I think with the current protocols, by the way, it's the way of life for every club at the moment.
Yeah, it certainly is with the current situation.
To be ball boy as the rain continues to fall on the Fylde coast.
It certainly does show this second half's been a massive turnaround, certainly for Fleetwood. Got hold of the ball better, played higher up the pitch. I think just the change of formation certainly been a big impact in particular.
Yeah, and this is the furthest forward we've seen Wes Burns, who had a tough-all job in the first half, trying to deal with Nkunku and Richarlison down his side. But now he's in an advanced position and pushing Mills and Nkunku back.
Well, yeah, it almost was a five-at-the-back situation because of the way Everton were playing, the dynamics, especially in the wide areas, they were forcing Fleetwood back.
There's a long throw now that we spoke about earlier from James Hill. Dealt with by Richarlison. Now Whelan. Danny Andrew. Quite what he was intending.
Yeah, I think, you know, you reflect on the first half of what Fleetwood done better. Yes, talked about the formation change and personnel, but I think they've kept the ball better, and that's just down to getting the ball into Ched Evans. I think Duffy coming on adds that little bit of dimension in midfield. And the two comfort blankets there with Whelan and Cooks.
Look at Fleetwood Town again, the cross comes to nothing, no real trouble for Jordan Pickford in the end. This is Fleetwood's ninth season as an EFL club, seventh in a row in the third tier of English football. The ambition is to be in the Premier League eventually. That's what they're building towards. Certainly have a Premier League ready training ground, there's no question about that. This is Anthony Gordon trying to outwit Burns. Now Bernard, Camps gets to it.
Yeah, it's a good save from Alex Cairns. Excellent play, Anthony Jordan direct. Just opens up all that space for Bernard. He's excellent in the first half. It's a good sort of size for him to get a good fingertips on and push wide.
Made that important save just before the break from Dominic Calvert-Lewin as well, Alex Cairns. Luca Dean on set piece duty again for Everton. Comfortable header away. Ched Evans doing the defending. There's Morris. Its budget in League One is between 6th to 10th. Amongst the other clubs in the third tier, they are operating now with a salary cap as well in League One. All clubs operating with a salary cap, which we believe will lead to a level playing field. This is Iwobi. Now Davis. Niels and Nkunku will get to it. Gideon picking out Jonjo Kenny. Kenny nicely gone into the path of Alex Iwobi. Kenny wants it back. Gylfi Sigurdsson. He's had to play in a deeper position at times under Carlo Ancelotti. Gylfi Sigurdsson, a position that when he plays there he's getting used to. Having to curb his natural instincts when he is playing in a deeper role. So he doesn't venture too far forward, and the centre-backs are telling him to stay back and stop counter-attacks. Not playing in that role particularly tonight, but he has been playing in that number six role at times under Carlo Ancelotti.
Yeah, he's got the ability, he's got the football brain, the football mind that he can pick a pass out. It's obviously the tracking runners, it's the different aspects of it all. Doing the horrible side of the game, which at times don't come natural to the more flair and ability players.
Here is Gylfi Sigurdsson, Jonjo Kenny, Richarlison in the middle. Away by Boys. He's played a couple of times for Liverpool, one being in the Carabao Cup last season. That defeat to Aston Villa when the Liverpool first team were contesting the Club World Cup. On his way on that far side of the pitch. Here he is. Here's Nkunku, got the better of Burns. Burns then got back goal side. Got a touch on it.
Well, it's so tight. He's literally on the byline and he pulls out a great little trick to drift past Burns. The ball wasn't great that he put in the box, but ends up resorting into a corner. Just feel like Everton haven't got or dictated in them central areas. Looking at Tom Davies or maybe Sigurdsson to drop back into that more defensive role and get them 5-10 passes in.
Sigurdsson's corner, Chet Evans again takes charge. There's Davies. Now Anthony Gordon. And Kunku. Hill in the way that time. There's Kenny. Anthony Gordon. Gordon again has got it back from Alex Iwobi. Fires the ball in low. It's Bernard! It's a thumping finish! This competition hasn't been too kind to Everton in the past, but they're looking to write happier memories this season. And they restore their two-goal advantage.
Yeah, well, Bernard's been very good, particularly in the first half when he dictated a lot of play, but look at what Anthony Gordon brings to this Everton side. He's drifted out on this right-hand side, plays a little ball to Iwobi. No one tracks the runner. He does get a bit fortunate, Bernard, but it's still an awful lot to do for him. And the technique and the ability to strike it with pace and power is absolutely first class. Alex Cairns got no chance of getting anywhere near it. Excellent finish, well executed by Bernard.
First goal since February 4, Bernard, who was one of the standout performers in the second round against Salford and has given a good account of himself here tonight. We said earlier on, he loves playing in this central position where he is involved a lot more. He's flourished in that role and he's got his goal tonight.
Well, he has picked up a lot of second balls that went up towards Calvert-Lewin in the first half, and he was one that picked up the second phase at times. Picked up any little bits, and he did that particularly well there, where he's just hovering in a good area, picking up the right spaces for anything that comes out. It's an excellent finish, it really is.
Well, can Fleetwood rally again? Double change on the way. Jamie Tete coming on to replace Paul Coutts. Tete on the field of play, 19-year-old. He replaces the experienced Paul Coutts. And off goes Chet Evans. Looking a few feathers at the start of the second half. And he's replaced by Harvey Saunders. Like for like, the place with a striker for a striker up front for Fleetwood. And Richarlison is replaced by Moyes Keane for Everton. So Harvey Saunders, who was signed January 2019 by Fleetwood, when he signed his professional contract, put pen to paper on the deal here. He rang the coffee shop where he worked and said, right, that's it, I'm quitting. Now here he is playing against Everton.
That's what dreams are made of.
Bernard. Iwobi. There's John Joe Kenny. Well, that time on Anthony Gordon by Wes Burns.
He It's an easy one as well. Just tries to get away as he drifts inside Anthony Gordon.
Next up for Fleetwood is a home game against Wimbledon as they look to claw their way out of League One. To be a fans test event, but they've had to rip up those plans. As Burns maybe need some attention here. They have made their changes at Fleetwood.
Well, that's a risky run, unfortunately. I think he's just, if he just overstretches as he tries to clear that ball, there's a little pull or little tightness on the car for the hamstring.
Live Championship football on Friday night comes from Huddersfield. Huddersfield Town against Nottingham Forest, 7 o'clock on Sky Sports Football. Forest looking to hit back after being beaten by Cardiff last weekend. And Saturday midday Sky Sports Football, it's Wickham against Swansea. Will be one member, maybe a few members of the Barton household who will be pleased with this scoreline at the moment. Joey Barton's son was going to be a Liverpool fan. Joey Barton did say to him, listen, that can't happen. But he kept coming home singing the Mo Salah song. He said, OK, if you become a Liverpool fan, I'm not buying you the kit or taking you to the game. But then, since Carlo Ancelotti's taken over, he now comes home and talks about Everton. So he's going to have to buy them the Everton kit. So Dad's team up against it here against Everton. But Everton in front, we said earlier on, it's a family full of Evertonians. So much so that when Joey Barton was on the books of Everton as a youngster, Steve Highway, Liverpool scout, former Liverpool player, phoned the Barton household. Joey Barton's dad got the phone and said, no, we're Evertonians, and put the phone down because Steve Highway was trying to take him to Liverpool. So a special night this tonight for Joey Barton. Carlo Ancelotti's Everton with 11 minutes plus additional time to play as it stands are heading into the fourth round.
He'll certainly be pleased with his second half performance, that's for sure. He showed a lot of character and that typifies Joey Barton, really does.
James Hill on the launch pad again here for Fleetwood. Picks out Danny Andrew this time. Hooked away by Nkunku. Knee in the back, a painful one that for Bernard.
I tell you what, just looking at Nkunku, the way that ball comes over, he's got no right to win the ball and he scoops it back over. Don't know how he done that. Shows so much ability this young man has. I feel like he's been at Everton for years. He looks like he's just slotted into that left-back role.
He was brought in originally to be part of the under-23 squad, but because Leighton Baines retired, it's pushed him further up the pecking order. Leighton Baines is now back at Everton as a professional development coach. The plan was originally for him to be part of the under-23 squad, but he's certainly making a name for himself. Anthony Gordon. There's Wheeler. Now Hill. Matete. There's Camps, who scored with an overhead kick here tonight. Dean across to his more natural position to deal with that.
Yeah, he's done well at centre-half. Obviously coming on in the last fixture against Salford. Did very well, been very comfortable at times. A lot more to do this second half.
Oh, Morgan Boys moves forward from the back. The previous throw didn't go inside the box from James Hill. It looks like this one will. Over the head of Boys and away by Keane. It's dropped here to Glenn Whelan.
Well, I was expecting Glenn to stick that in the top bin. A couple of times I've seen him do that, but on the most I've seen him do what he just did then, and that was volley straight over the bar.
Yeah, he's had better moments.
He's not known for that, is he, really, Glenn? But sometimes it happens. It's still really nice for him, though.
Everton 8 minutes away from safely negotiating a passage into the fourth round, a tie against West Ham. Against David Moyes, a home tie in the next round. Apologies if you were offended by the language you just heard. But. In terms of Everton, though, they have been under the stewardship of Farhad Bashiri, who's invested over £550 million in transfer fees in the last 4 years. He always planned to bring in the Hollywood name as Everton manager. He's done that. And he wants the Hollywood ending, a trophy, and to muscle their way into the top four in the next couple of years. They have spent a lot of money. Hoping that it pays off in the next couple of years, Everton.
Yeah, they're heading in the right direction. I really think they are, particularly this season. And Alan Rodriguez, who we've spoke about, Decore, some very, very good players. And we look at the youthful side of the team. Those who are on show today, Anthony Gordon, one of them. And Cuckoo, very, very good as well. You've got lots of strength and depth. You're thinking you've got an outstanding manager who certainly will get the best out of this Everton squad.
Yeah, in terms of the James Rodriguez transfer fee, it was reported it was £20 million. We understand it's nowhere near that. They bought out the final year of his contract. He isn't involved at all tonight. Moyes Keane trying to get involved. He would have been disappointed not to start tonight, Moyes Keane, having struck against Salford last week. He scored 3 goals in his last 3 starts. But Carlo Ancelotti went with a really strong team from the off here. And as we heard him say before the game, he didn't want to upset the momentum of the likes of Dominic Calvert-Lewin, who's scored 4 goals so far this season, or of Richarlison.
And you can see the reason why, that kind of, you know, obviously the main aim this season is the Premier League status and where they can finish. Half as possible, possibility of Europe. When your striker's in form, you want to keep him in form.
That's Morris, who can score from distance, unable to get that on target.
He found himself in a bit of space. Morris did good turn, just drags his shot wide though. Not even tested. Jordan Pickford.
To League One action for Joey Barton and Fleetwood at the weekend. For Carlo Ancelotti at Everton, it's a trip to Crystal Palace. Moyes Keane beaten in the air by Hill. It's Camps. It's Colin Camps again, robbed of the ball by a hungry John Joe Kenny. And Kenny has picked out Anthony Gordon. He's still looking for his first goal for Everton.
Yeah, and I thought that was the one. Excellent hustle and bustle by John Joe Kenny, and picks Anthony Gordon out. Still quite some way out. Great ability to take it first time.
Well, So he's still looking for his first goal for Everton. He obviously hasn't been involved too much, burst onto the scene at the back end of last season, but he was desperate for his goal against Salford last week. This is Gylfi Sigurdsson. Bernard. Gordon again. Caught late.
Yeah, very late as well it was. I don't know whether that was just the slippy surface.
Well, they'll sleep well tonight, West Burns, because he's had to put a real shift in on that right-hand side for Fleetwood, dealing with Everton, particularly in that first half. And that man was operating on that side of the pitch, Richarlison, who scored twice tonight for Everton. Might claim an assist as well for a step over for the third.
There's no doubt about that. There's no doubt.
Those boys stepping forward. Duffy. Danny Andrew. Duffy again. That's Matete. This is Morris. Matete. He hasn't managed to deal with it. But Harvey Saunders was asking questions there. Matete. Clean challenge.
Excellent play by Matete in there. Getting on the ball, looking to pick passes out. Certainly that introduction. Substitutes have done well when they've come on. Duffy.
If it's going to happen for Fleetwood to send this to penalties, it has to happen now. And it could have happened a few moments ago when they were asking a question or two again at the Everton back line.
Yeah, they've been so much better in possession of the ball this second half. Ask questions, more bodies around, a lot more enthusiasm.
John Joe Kenny. Towards four additional minutes at the end of this game. Matete. That's Andrew. Now, boys. Of those four additional minutes as Gylfi Sigurdsson links up with John Joe Kenny. Plenty of encouragement for Joey Barton to take from the second half display from Fleetwood. In the first half, Everton sparkled.
Yeah, they really did. They exposed Fleetwood at times and kept the ball so well. Bags of possession. Lots of authority. Second half, not in the same. But then the intensity they did play within that first half. You're asking an awful lot over the 90 minutes. And Joey Barton making the changes, which he felt was needed. Made a big impact.
There's Duffy. Iwobi. John Joe Kenny demanding a little flick there from Iwobi, but he's unable to pick him out. Matete. There's Camps.
Oh,
Metete, hunted down by Bernard. We've seen the silk and the steel of Bernard tonight at the heart of the Everton midfield.
A stake to claim tonight he has. He really was my standout player in the first half in particular.
Glenn Whelan just gets away from Burns. Everton have been runners-up in this competition twice, back in 1977, the seemingly never-ending final against Aston Villa, and also back in 1984. Beaten by a Graham Souness rocket at Main Road in the replay after a goalless draw at Wembley when Everton thought they were denied a penalty in that final. The competition has also provided a big turning point in their history as well. The game at Oxford back in 1984, Kevin Brock, who provided arguably Everton's most important assist, but he never played for them. The short back pass which Adrian Heath put away to level up at the Manor Ground. Everton won the replay, and under Howard Kendall, they never looked back. But they still never won this trophy. Luca Dean. And Nkunku. It's in his mind this time, and Nkunku finds Moise Keane. It's another goal for Moise Keane in an Everton shirt, made by Niels Nkunku, who's been outstanding tonight on the left-hand side. And it's the perfect ending to almost the perfect night for Everton.
Well, I've got to take my hat off to this young man. I just love his energy, I really do. And it's a great ball over the back four. And look at the cheek of it. A back heel straight into the path of Moise Keane. Absolute ability to die for. It really is, shows how much confidence he's got, makes it so much easier for Moise Keane to come on and get his goal. But excellent build-up play, I've got to say, big smile on his face as well, well earned this evening, been superb for me.
Moise Keane with the goal, Niels Nkunku with the assist, and if Everton have paid just £250,000 in compensation for Niels Nkunku, that's money very well spent. For the most part, Everton sparkled here tonight as they look for their first piece of silverware in 25 years. They've knocked out Fleetwood Town in the Carabao Cup. Richarlison with a double. Fleetwood Town then pull one back through Mark Duffy before goals from Alex Iwobi and Callum Camp still made it a contest. And then right at the end there, Moise Keane made it number five for Everton after Bernard had also struck for the Blues tonight. Fleetwood gave a good account of themselves in the second half, but Everton kept them at arm's length. It's finished, Fleetwood Town 2, Everton 5.
Five goals they may have scored, but at times they made it very tough. Joey Barton's Fleetwood against Everton. A much changed Everton side coming into this one. Finally showed their quality over the course of 90-plus minutes, putting five past an unfortunate Fleetwood, meaning the Toffees progress, of course, to the next round. Again, a seven-goal thriller here at the Highbury Stadium was kicked off by brace from Richarlison in the first half, using his head for his first and his toe for his second. Everton 2-0 up at half-time. Matt Duffy came on, though, at half-time for Fleetwood and clawed one back before Alex Iwobi replied 99 seconds later to put Everton 3-1 up. Callum Camps, though, his overhead kick just fumbled into the net by Jordan Pickford, had Everton worried. Once again, their quality toll. Bernard smashing in from just inside the 18-yard box to make it four before another substitute, Moise Keane, made it five in added on time. 5-2, it's finished to the visitors. Here's how the game broke down. A hell of a lot of attempts for Everton. Fleetwood, though, credits to them for being efficient. Three attempts on target, two goals, more touches in the opposition box and, of course, more possession for the Premier League side. Alex Iwobi was a player that came into the side looking to make an impression. He scored a goal and also set one up. Here he is now
with David Craig.
Alex, does that result tonight underline the good form that Everton are currently in at this moment?
Yeah, it shows the confidence and the quality we have. We have strength and depth. We're able to rotate the team and get a performance today. So, yeah, it shows that we have a good team for the season.
And for you personally, to get a 90-plus minutes, what does that mean?
Yeah, it's good. It's a good experience for me trying to get fit and ready for both all competitions, to be fair. So it's good for the manager to give me the opportunity today.
A little bit extra special, capping it with a goal as well.
Yeah, it's always good to score, but the main thing is that the team goes through to the next round, so I'm glad I was able to help.
And does it also give the manager a little bit of food for thought? Because obviously you want first team starts in the Premier League as well.
Of course, I mean, everyone wants to play, and I'm trying to do my best to play in all competitions, like I said, so hopefully I can give him a migraine and get involved as much as I can.
How difficult did Fleetwood make it for you tonight, particularly when it came back to 2-1?
Yeah, especially second half, I think they changed the formation and they were more attacking, so you can't. They have a great team, as they showed. They were able to get two goals against us, but then again, we're able to withstand it and come out of going on to the next round.
Home to West Ham in the next round. Is this a competition that Everton are targeting this season?
Like I said, we're targeting every competition. If you're in a competition, you have to try and win it. So on to the next round, and hopefully we can beat West Ham as well.
Well, listen, well done to you. Bernard was the Carabao Cup man of the match. Would you kindly give it to him in the
dressing? I'll score it to him, no worries. Thank you.
Or you can share it.
A smile there to light up any football stadium on the planet. Alex Iwobi very happy with his performance, his goal, and walking off with the man of the match. And also talking to David Craig, of course. Jamie Redknapp and Leon Osman are alongside me here in the studio. Leon, Everton had the quality on show. They played as well as they possibly could. The 5-2 perhaps a little harsh on Fleetwood, but again, we see the gulf between a Premier League side and what Fleetwood had to offer, don't we?
Yeah, I think the stats there would tell you everything you need to know about the game. I felt Everton dominated possession. They created chances, really good chances, moved the Fleetwood side around. And I think Carlo Ancelotti will have been delighted with, let's say, 13 of the 14 players out there tonight for Everton.
And we'll come on to Fleetwood in due course, but what you saw there from the Everton players, we saw the changes that were made. Has there been plenty that have put their names into the hat for the next game?
Yes, there's so much quality. I've enjoyed watching Everton. The side, I said it before the game, I'm really enjoying the way they play. They're expansive, they're playing with ease. You know, the game looks really easy for them. And I think what we're alluding to there is the goalkeeper. I mean, they're so in control of that game. And then the keeper throws in too, and then it just becomes a different game altogether. But they still had that quality when they needed it. He's bringing on subs that are making a difference. Bernard in central midfield today looks like the player that I think all Evertonians were hoping they were going to sign. It doesn't suit him playing wide. Play him in a central position. And they've got so many good players. All of a sudden, the squad looks strong. You've got good players coming off the bench. I'll be very excited if I'm an Evertonian right now. And there's plenty. He's been smiling all game. You've been enjoying it, Leon. So it's been... No, they're playing really good stuff. The manager's got them playing in exactly the right manner.
We'll come on to Jordan Pickford in due course. But as we were watching the first half, Leon was talking about how Richarlison has looked like he's had a bit of a bee in his bonnet. Did he put that to bed in the first half for you?
Yeah, well, you know, last season he was Everton's go-to guy. You know, if Everton were going to create something or make something happen, it was him. But at the start of this season, James and Dominic Calvert-Lewin have had all the plaudits in the opening few games. And you just felt that about his performance tonight. He wanted to go out there and make sure it was himself getting the headlines in the morning. And I felt he did that, no matter where he was on the field. You know, we saw him on the right on that occasion here. We'll probably see him popping up on the left-hand side. He wanted to drift. He wanted to be in possession. Jamie alluded to that skill before, the rollover drag. Retaining the ball in tight areas of the field and still managing to show that sharpness and that turn of speed to get in good places to score goals.
Does it bode well for Everton moving forward that you've got a centre-forward that's got the bit between his teeth because of the players who have come to the fore? Is it pushing him on?
Yeah, absolutely. And I think you've got options, and that's what you're looking for as a manager, because you've got Calvert-Lewin that can play. And I also like the fact that we talked about the two goals. Leon was saying it off air that both goals coincide with him playing off the left, on the right, and that's what you want. You've got to be elusive. You've got to bring goals to the table. If you look at Liverpool's front three, they all score goals, and that's what you want from the manager will want that, and he'll be demanding it every day in training, because if they can all chip in, you're in a really great position. You know, you've got James, who didn't even, you know, wasn't featured today, and they have got an awful amount of quality. They are looking very good, and I like what the manager's doing. They're working hard. Even when that little bit of adversity, when sometimes they might have struggled, you know, they conceded the two goals, they still got back on it. They never stopped doing the right things. I was very impressed with them.
Speaking of conceding two goals, you mentioned a player that perhaps hasn't covered himself in glory. credit to Fleetwood for getting back into the game, but are these firmly filed under goalkeeping mistakes?
I think they have to be. Michael Keane maybe gave him a short pass back to him, but as a goalkeeper, you've got to know when you've got to get rid of the ball, you've got to empty the situation, you've got to know for when to panic, for want of a better term. And he thought he had the opportunity to take a touch. Two Fleetwood players managed to close him down inside his own six-yard box. Gets ricochets, falls nicely into the path of Duffy, who calmly puts it into the back of the goal. But from an opening 45 minutes of dominance, suddenly Fleetwood are right back in the game and on the front foot.
And is it two very different mistakes we're looking at here?
Yeah, James? Well, look at him here. He goes to get one. Right after that moment, it's like your head's in a tumble dryer. You don't know what to do. You try to make up for the mistake. I think he should actually do better. I don't want to take anything away from the finish because, you know, it's a lovely piece of play by Callum Camps. He improvises really well. But even then, look at the way that he tries to save it. You know, his confidence isn't at the highest. You can see he tries to sort of catch it, palm it away, and as you say, he doesn't cover himself in glory at all. And they're mistakes that are compounded because he makes the first one. Look, you know, even going back to the first, I think, you know, you've explained it perfectly, Leon, but goalkeepers have got to know when the ball has got to go. And I think it went a similar one with Kepa the weekend. You try to play it from the back, and the modern game...
Is there a bit about being too clever? Is it almost seen as too agricultural to pump it away from your goal?
I think it is, but you have to know when it's the right time. If you're getting pressed like you are, and Fleetwood, it's the first couple of minutes into the second half, you know, they're starting to put you under a bit of pressure. You've just got to let it go. And there's no problem with that. And then you ask questions later, you push the back four up, you perhaps say to, you know, Michael Kitt, that wasn't the best pass in the world, but just deal with it. Don't take... Why are you taking a touch? You know your surroundings, and all you do is cause yourself a lot of problems.
I think it's quite fortunate tonight that there's an empty stadium. You can imagine, you know, having been dominated for the opening 45 minutes, Fleetwood come out at the start of the second half, score a goal like that, and suddenly the crowd are baying for blood. They're right on top. It's a close-knit stadium. You can feel the atmosphere. Everton could have wobbled at that point, you know, trying to keep themselves in the game. You expect a 10, 15 minutes of being under severe pressure at that moment, but... Fortunate, Everton just seems to calm down with these empty stadiums. Everton start playing the football again and score again within 90 seconds.
We should keep him under the microscope, though, of Everton fans, Jordan Pickford.
It certainly does. You know, he had a tough end of last season, shall we say, where these type of mistakes were seeping into his game. And you hope that he'd be able to sort them out. At the start of the season, I know we're only three games in before tonight, you felt that maybe we were seeing the old Jordan Pickford, full of confidence, making the right decisions, but today is a concern again.
Yeah. Alex Iwobi came into the side. Quite clearly, he was living his best life this evening, wasn't he? He had a wonderful night's work.
You know, when he signed for Arsenal, it hasn't quite worked out for him. But you can see when everyone... It's difficult, so when you come into a team and they're not exactly full of confidence, no one's playing well, it makes it very hard for you. But when you're coming in and playing like this, you want to be part of it. I mean, I'm not quite sure that's an over by Richarlison there, are you, Leon?
But he tried to claim
it. No, I don't think it is.
Yeah, but I'm pleased for him because he's obviously got talent. But sometimes you come to the team and everyone's lacking confidence. No one really wants the ball. But right now, everyone is buzzing in this Everton team. And that's just going, you know, going back to Jordan Pickford. I don't want to jump into his nightmare, but we should be talking about not far off a perfect night for Everton. There were so many things to admire about them. And you end up talking and reflecting about, you know, goalkeepers' two mistakes, which could really have cost them.
Iwobi came in and made an impression. Did Bernard come in and make an impression as well to get himself into the opening Premier League side?
I think it'd be tough to force yourself into Everton's first team at the moment, but all you can do is perform in these games. And I was also pleased for Anthony Gordon, who found himself on the bench after a great game against Salford in the last round, come on at half-time and had two assists within 20 minutes or so. So I think all three of those players, Iwobi, Gordon, Bernard, all really asked the manager a question tonight. The technique there on the finish is fantastic. He just timed his connection right. He slowed himself down, kept his eye on the ball and made sure it didn't rise over the top of the crossbar.
I mean, you're right about the technique. I think to a certain extent, when you ask him a question about can he get into the team, obviously there's so many players in that position. But the way, if they feature in midfield, say, with Allen and Decore, they're almost the perfect foil for him, like his minders to a certain extent, because you can get him in the ball in those little pockets in those central areas. The ball for the first goal is sensational. Not many players can pick that up. I'm thinking, oh, he's going to shoot here. Instead, he delivers a pinpoint, you know, accuracy pass into Richarlison. So I think he's not probably going to start, but there's definitely... He can come on and give you various options.
I think you're right. I think his problem last season was he was playing in a midfield where he was asked to help to win the ball back.
Yeah.
You know, you had Davis and Gomez in the middle of Everton's midfield, and Everton found it very difficult to get the ball back off any team they played against. So I think the fact that you're saying Decore's in there, Allen's in there, these are players that have great dynamism, they can win the ball back, and feed someone like the players we're talking about, Bernardo, Obi Gordon, and I think that this could give them an opportunity to thrive in Everton's first team.
Moise Kean was a player that came on and also got himself on the score sheet, scoring Everton's fifth. But again, it was good work down the left-hand side, which you saw lots of, Jamie.
It really was. You know, and Cuckoo just looks the real deal. It's going to be hard for him. He's got Digne ahead of him and not always going to get a regular game. But it gives you so many options, and it's a really good finish for Moise Kean. We both looked at each other at the same time and said that he needs that. It's great for his confidence because, again, you can see there is a player in there, but it just hasn't worked out for him so far. But when you start to get this and everyone's buying into what Carlo's doing right now, it feels it's so exciting. He has got talent. He's not ahead of Dominic Calvert-Lewin by any stretch of the imagination. But if Dominic were to pick up a couple of injuries or you want to freshen up, certainly go a long way in this tournament, you're going to need your whole squad.
So when you see that performance, and obviously you throw it forward looking into the game at the weekend in the Premier League, what the biggest positives that Carlo Ancelotti takes from this? Is it the sheer depth that he's got available now as Everton manager?
It's the depth, and it's knowing that, because the players have showed you that if he needs them, if he asks them to go out there and perform in his first team, they're all right at that level. They're not coming in saying they're not ready or asking for fitness. They know now with the squad depth that Everton have got and the performance level that the opening two or three games have showed, they have to be at the top of their game, and this kind of performance shows them that.
OK, good night's work then for Everton at Fleetwood. 5 goals they've scored against Joey Barton's side. All smiles and plenty of respect between the two ahead of the game. We'll get their post-match thoughts after the break. So 4 wins out of 4. It's an excellent start to this season for Everton and Carlo Ancelotti. His thoughts now with David Craig.
Carlo, a fairly comprehensive victory in the end, but did your opponents make you pull out all the stops this evening?
Oh, I think that the performance that we had in the first half was good. We were focused, concentrated, we played well. We were 2-0 up. After that, we were not so... We didn't start the second half with intensity, but the game was in control until the end.
We talked before the game about players who would maybe give you something to think about. Did the likes of Alex Iwobi do that this evening?
I think in general the performance was good. Iwobi did well. He came back after an injury. He had a good performance. I am pleased about the performance because was not easy to prepare. We have a lot of games. The player that didn't play a lot that played tonight, they played well. So the momentum is good of the team.
A couple of mistakes this evening from Jordan Pickford. Are you and both he frustrated about the way he conceded those goals?
Oh, when we concede a goal, we are always frustrated, but I think it was a general mistake, not individual mistake.
West Ham in the next round. We talked about the importance of this competition, the good form that your team are in this season. Is this a competition you see as very winnable to get Everton a first trophy in 25 years?
No. Short competition, and so miss, I think, 3 games to the final, so it's not a lot. We have to be ready.
Just finally, transfer window still open. You've had an excellent start to the season. Would you still like to add some further quality to this squad?
I have 31 players in the squad. It's too much. It's difficult to manage. So the market is open. We have a look for this, but I have 31 players in the squad.
Carlo, thank you.
Thank you.
Carlo Ancelotti taking it all in his stride this evening. Leon, have we got, have Everton got the perfect manager in charge to be able to get that first trophy in 25? He's a serial winner wherever he's been, hasn't he?
He has, and I do believe that he is the perfect man to be in charge of Everton at the moment. You've seen his desire he still has to win trophies, his desire he has to come to Everton and be part of a project that's probably different from ones he's had before, but it's a project still to win silverware, and that's the ultimate goal. And you can see by the strength of team he's put out tonight, you can see by the calibre of players he's bringing into Everton Football Club, how he wants to go and where he sees that project going. So I'm really pleased he put a strong team out tonight because, you know, when you have moments in games, when things go against you, as a couple of things did, a couple of moments in the game from tonight, you've still got that strong team to see you through the game.
And especially because the way you finished last season, Everton, I feared a little bit from this season. I thought, will that carry on? And he addressed it. Start of the year, I need to get some midfield players in the start of the season. and he's done that. And you can already see that that's made a massive impact on the team. The Tottenham result was giving them the confidence and the belief, and they're just growing every game. I watch them.
Do they take influence perhaps from what Mourinho and Guardiola have done when they've come in? Depending on how you view the different silverware that's available across a domestic season, they went quickly, got the Carabao Cup, gets them up and running, gets the trophy in the cabinet, gives them time to progress, doesn't it?
Yeah, I think so. And also as a manager or as a player, you want to create momentum. You want to you've got a good feeling, you feel great after the Tottenham result, you want to carry on that performance, you want to give players an opportunity. I mean, the last round against Salford, he made a lot of changes, but even the changes he made had an impact in the game. They weren't sulking. They wanted to go out and show the manager they want to be part of this, like you just said, about a project we're trying to create here. And if you can get everyone buying into that, because the hardest thing is to manage the squad, the players that don't play. It's all right with your starting 11, but it's the ones that you're going to bring onto the pitch. Are they going to show that same attitude? And they have. I don't see anybody at all sulking. Everyone wants to buy into what Everton are doing right now. I'm actually worried because I'm really enjoying Everton right now. This is a problem. This is a problem, Liam.
We're just about to some stage. Jamie mentions the changes in the Salford game, Leon, and it was Niels Nkunku that played well in that Salford game, but also did himself no harm tonight with his performance on the left-hand side, didn't he?
No, he's been terrific on both occasions we've seen him. He is a left-back, but he's one that certainly doesn't mind being in advanced positions, and when he does get in here, his quality is fantastic. He has the pace to drop shoulders. He can deliver without beating a defender. He can go past the defender. And more often than not, he's picking the right option, which is something that young players don't always do. It takes a little bit of experience and time to pick the right option more often than not. But at 19 years old, he's had a terrific introduction into the Everton team.
Jamie, is there a kind of a glorious simplicity here that when he's in a position to cross the ball, that's all he does is cross the ball?
He flashes it across the face, but he's also got quality like that. You know, there comes a time where you need a little bit of finesse, a bit of subtlety, and he offers that. And Leon and I were saying, when you're trying to pick your best Everton team, you're going to have different challenges along the way. You might have a situation where you maybe play him as a left midfielder. You could almost play as a three and play with Digne as one of the left-sided centre-backs. So he's a wing-back because he obviously loves to get forward. And that's what you want as a manager, because you get different challenges along the way. You might have to stop a right-back that's going to come raiding. You don't want to play maybe Richarlison as a left-sided player in case the right-back's coming on, causing you problems, to maybe thicken it up and be difficult to beat. Because right now, they look impressive, but you are going to get a lot of challenges. And to have that depth of squad that Everton have right now, it's all you can ask for as a manager, because they haven't had that in the last few years, really, have you, Leon? You haven't had to bring on players that can make a difference.
No, definitely not. And he was just asked the question at the end as he finished with his squad and, you know, time is open. I do think he'd still like to bring in a central defender. You've got Luca Dean filling in as a central defender tonight because of a couple of injuries in that position. But, you know, other than that, I think he's really pleased with what he's got.
So, Jerry Barton, of course, the boyhood Everton fan. So, perhaps mixed emotions at the end of this one. Let's find out. Here he is with David Craig.
Joe, it was a tough task in front of you tonight, but is the scoreline a fair reflection on your team's efforts this evening?
When you play against players of that calibre, you make mistakes, they put it in the back of your net. And, you know, when you've got the likes of Richarlison and Bernard and Iwobi, Sigurdsson about, you're always going to be tested. And it's a tough learning lesson for some of our younger players out there. But I said to him in the dressing room at half-time, you know, you've got to make a cup tie out of it. You're maybe guilty of showing them a little bit too much respect in the first period. And they came out second half and made a cup tie. You know, we had Everton a little bit worried, probably have a stage in that game. And then we undone ourselves by giving them the third goal. So lessons to learn, but really, really pleased. A lot of young players out there, and that'll carry a lot of good things for them over the stages of their career, you know, certainly at this young stage, but also as they get and they progress up the football ladder. I think, you know, to play against those top level players and to compete and do well for periods will no doubt bring the confidence on.
When Mark Duffy brought it back to 2-1, obviously no crowds in at the moment, but what difference would the home crowd possibly have made in that situation?
Yeah, we've all seen it down the years, you know, when the crowd get behind a team and you get that little bit of momentum. Who knows? It would have been nice, but unfortunately we undone ourselves by conceding not long afterwards and allowing them off the hook a little bit to 3-1, and then we get back in at 3-2, and, you know, you're thinking, can we make a fist of it again? And, you know, they rotate and they manage to bring on another couple of internationals for the internationals who go off the park. And, you know, with young Anthony Gordon there, his pace on the counter-attack towards the end was always going to cause us a problem. And, you know, we made a cup tie out of it, and it'll look 5-2 in the paper. And I've just seen I think Newcastle won 7-0 tonight, Chelsea won 6-0 tonight. So at half time, you are always worried, you know, that you're 2-0 down and will the Galacticos go into overdrive in the second half? And thankfully, we made a cup tie out of it. But really pleased, and now it's back to the bread and butter of the league on Saturday.
Just finally on the game, Carlo Ancelotti's just been here. He said his squad is too big at 31 players. Will you be tapping on his door to see if he can loan you a few?
Well, we'll certainly find some minutes for some of them if Carlo's struggling with them. But yeah, I mean, you know, that's the difference, isn't it? When you see, you know, the calibre of players, and that's, you know, a strong Everton side tonight, but they've still got, you know, probably the superstars left at home. You know, Alan and James Rodriguez and you know, you look at that and think it must be incredible to have that amount of talent in your group. So, you know, Carlo's a top level manager. He's managed some of the biggest clubs around, and you know, to see Everton back moving in the right direction, I think is, for an Evertonian's great, albeit tapered a little bit today because, you know, my team have conceded 5 goals. So really, really pleased with the cup tie. Apart from obviously the fact that we now exit it, because you know, for our club, the money we got from the Sky game is massive, especially you know what's going on in the world, and I think it's a really good occasion for us, obviously apart from the 5 goals.
Joey, thank you.
Pragmatic perspective from Joey Barton, the Fleetwood Town manager. The Everton starting 11, £210 million to put together. The Fleetwood, only 3 of them have actually paid fees for. Mm. What does Joey take from that? Because at one stage, as he said, his team gave it a hell of a go, didn't they?
Yeah, I mean, there was a huge gulf in class, is whatever way you put it, and I think Joey's bright enough to realise that this is not going to determine the rest of their season to a certain extent. They can just get on with the league now. It was nice to play against an Everton side, and it's also nice to a certain extent, although they'll be hurting in there, because I think there'll be a lot of players that will think, we perhaps didn't show our best, we probably showed them too much respect. That's the level that you've got to adhere to. That's the level you've got to try and get to. For those midfield players that are trying to get closer to the likes of Bernard in there and realising these guys are the best, that's why I watch him on the TV in the Premier League. So for him, to a certain extent, he'll explain to his players, that's how hard you've got to work. So there'll be elements that he'll be pleased with, but I think it was just a massive gulf in class between the two teams.
Gives him that bit of extra, I don't know, yardstick to show what these players could be capable of, perhaps, Leon.
Yeah, but as Jamie says, that the gulf is clear. I think that sometimes when you're playing lower league football, you always believe that you can give best you can, that you can match the players in the Premier League if you're going to play against them. I think the crowd always is a leveller, and I think that they've seen that today, but now it's an opportunity to get back to their league football and see if they can push themselves up in League One.
Gents, top stuff as ever. Here's what's coming up on Sky.